Hi, I'm Scott Shipe. I'm here today at Washington County Free Library, and I'm at the Western Maryland Room. And I'm honored to be with John Frye, and I want to wish you a happy birthday,
John. Well, thank you.
And it's a
pop up every year.
Certainly, your big celebration here today. John, I'd like to talk about Hancock today in pre-colonial, colonial, and post-colonial period, and find out what was going on at Hancock in, say, 1700.
Aside from some sort of a crossing there, not much. In fact, the Hancock people questioned their early history. Was there a ferry operator there named Hancock? They think so. And whether they can prove it or not, they haven't really been able to make concrete to prove. But so Hancock's first history would have been just strictly a river crossing.
Okay.
Up and down the valleys. And just below there, though, in what's now West Virginia at Berkeley Springs, you had the mineral or hot springs. And Native Americans knew about those. And so they called them warm springs. But they knew about the medicinal effects of the springs at Bath or Berkeley Springs. So it's probably at a crossing point before even the European settlers arrived.
Okay, because of that spring.
Because of the medicinal springs and the warm springs there, yeah.
Wow, interesting. Mm-hmm. So say like 1740, what's going on there before the...
In the Hancock area, not much.
Not much.
Maybe one or two land grants. Old Mr. Flint supposedly was up there about that time. Mm-hmm. But that is far frontier in 1740s.
Wow.
You have to realize that the first land grants in what's now Washington County in the central and eastern part date about 1729. So that was real wilderness in 1740.
Right. So this would have been, it would have been all forests in that area, correct?
Well, yeah.
100%.
Certainly up there, but 100%, except maybe some shallows or swamp areas where a tree wouldn't grow. But
right.
Yeah, it's still been virgin forest in that
right.
time. Yeah.
It would have been incredible to see that.
Yeah.
Definitely.
But Hancock really probably didn't come into what it did become a small town until the completion of the National Road, the Maryland branch, or the Baltimore branch of the National Road, and went right through the middle of Hancock, and a great stopping point on the then very active National Road. But canal reaching there by mid-1830s, operating as far west as Great Capon by 1742. So then that began to make Hancock a real enterprising town, both the canal and National Road. Railroad on the other side affected it some, but not too much.
Okay.
And
when was the first bridge built there? You know
well,
that?
I don't know. I don't know the dates of when they built the first bridge, because it was a ferry operation there. The bridge that went out in 1936 was located where that lower bridge crosses the canal yet today. Isn't there a bridge that crosses the canal there or not?
There is. Yes, sir. That's correct. Yep.
I'm assuming that's probably where the lower bridge was, the 36 foot.
Right.
Yeah, before they built the ones there now.
Yes, sir.
But I don't know the dates of the bridge
okay.
that I'm looking at.
That's just one bridge I don't know much about.
Yeah.
I just don't know any history on that bridge.
But there was not a bridge there, I'm almost certain, mm-hmm. during the Civil War when Jackson attacked Hancock in 1861. I'm pretty sure there was not a bridge there at that time. And so there's no evidence of burning a bridge during the Civil War.
What was
like they did the rest of it?
Was there a ferry operating?
Well, ferry been operating.
Ferry been operating
oh, yeah.
there. So yeah. it would about where the bridge is now. Is
probably
where the,
yeah.
Is about where the ferry was.
That's where the ferry would have crossed. Very
yes,
close
sir.
There.
Right.
Yeah.
So John, do you consider Hancock a port town? Was it a port town?
The canal didn't affect Hancock as much as a lot of people thought it would. It was more of a national road town.
Okay.
But there was a lot of hope that the national road transportation and canal transportation would link up there. So, it was a canal town. A lot of folks worked on the canal.
Mm-hmm. And you had the
there was shipping on the canal.
Right, and you had that large cement company.
Well, that was on above, yeah,
right.
Round top cement.
Right.
But used the canal, and cement on the canal
right.
was mined there, but...
That was operating during the Civil War, or in that.
I think so, yeah, I don't know.
Okay.
Without looking up, I don't know that he...
It's definitely a unique cement company.
Yeah, it was hydraulic cement.
Right.
And, they shipped on the canal. They also shipped across the river to the B&O Railroad. That is not in canal, in Hancock. It was about 6 miles north.
Right.
And Round Top, yeah.
Right.
And but it was a local, small industrial town, very much an agriculture town with the orchard industry, and a very, very active town until the Interstate 70 bypass. And that really, really hurt Hancock, continues to hurt it even yet today from the standpoint of industrial enterprise.
Right.
And it's had its small industries come and go. One time there was what they called a sumac or shumac industry up there. That was pretty prominent. And
John, didn't floods plague Hancock?
Oh yeah, they still do.
Right. I mean, I've seen pictures of the 36 flood, and the water actually, when you walk out to Weaver's, the water elevation 36 would have basically, you would have stepped in water just kind of right there.
The whole upper end of Hancock flooded.
Right.
And in fact, after the 85 flood, they began to buy some of those houses in the flood area so they could get them out of the flood area, which they did.
Mm-hmm.
There's still a couple businesses left there in the flood area.
Yeah, there's a hardware store and then, yes sir.
And in fact, in 85, the C&O Canal headquarters in Hancock flooded.
Okay.
Because it was in the upper end of Hancock.
Well, you would have been there then.
I wasn't correct? Up there. I was on dispatch when the flood went on.
Okay.
But we knew about it, yeah, and we knew it was flooding and we knew it was going underwater.
Yes, sir. So that was always a problem there, right?
Flooding's still a problem with Hancock, sure.
Yeah, definitely.
But they have moved some of those homes out of the floodplain, mm-hmm. and some of those folks and businesses. But there's still that area on the you'd consider the western end along the river, still very much in the floodplain.
Definitely, right. Interesting.
And the creek that comes in also floods because that's what flooded the library twice.
Yes, sir. Right. Yeah.
Just asked our library director about flooding.
Yeah.
In Hancock Library.
All right. Well, I've seen the flood bark. I mean, where it was, it's just mind-boggling how far up in that park that water went.
Well, 36 was the highest flood, but 85 was pretty bad up there.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So the Tonoloway Creek.
Tonoloway.
You have aqueduct. I think that's aqueduct number 8 there.
Might be.
I think it's.
Call it the Bowles or B-O-W-L-E-S.
But it's a beautiful aqueduct because they built it right in the bedrock there.
Well, it also ties into a lock.
Yes.
It's the only aqueduct that goes tied right into a lock on the canal.
Right. It's just it's a beautiful aqueduct. It really is.
Well, Seneca though, it ties into
Seneca
that lock.
Also is a lock also. Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. Right. But anyway, I was just curious. The Bowles house is close to that.
Mm-hmm.
And what was significant about Bowles' house there? Because that seems like that's one of the oldest houses up there.
I don't know anything about the history of the house, but the family dates back considerably there, a prominent family.
Right.
Like I think here at the library we have a book on that family.
Right.
Or research on that family anyway.
Anyway, well, that house is very close, as you well know, it's very close to the mouth there. And to that aqueduct in that area. I was curious. But was there any other significant families up in that area in the, say, the 17, 18?
Well, I don't know about back that early. Later on, you had families like the Cohill family and the Orchard family.
The Hepburns?
Hepburn. But there was another prominent family up there.
Okay.
In the orchard business.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So how did all those orchards convert into this big preserve up there in Woodmont?
Well, even with Woodmont, though, there were still a lot of orchards, a lot of orchards up there. They operated up until about 30 years ago when the government sat down on these migrant workers, and that killed the orchards up there.
Because there was a couple thousand acres of orchards in that area.
Yeah, migrant workers would come in every year.
Right. Just like Berkeley County and
Then area. They come up with a lot of rules and regulations. And the places where they used the migrant workers could no longer do it.
Right.
And rather than try to survive, they just closed down.
Yes, sir. And, so Woodmont, what's the date on that? Woodmont, explain what that... what that was all about.
It was a private hunt club.
Okay.
Started by Bridges. It was strictly one of those things where, a lot of rich guys got together and bought the land and formed a hunt club so they'd have a place to party and come and hunt.
Right. And it's quite the fence around that place.
It was all closed, all private.
Right.
Before presidential retreats, the presidents visit there. It was one of the retreat areas.
Right.
And they used to have a chair up there that called the president's chair.
Yes, sir.
At Woodmont. I don't know whether they still have it or not.
I don't know. I don't know that much about it.
It's now owned by the state.
Right.
State preserve.
So
no longer a private club.
Right. So this private club was built, in the 1880s?
I don't know whether it was that earlier or not.
Okay.
I don't know. It may have been. I don't know the date.
I've been down to it a couple of times.
I've been there several times, yeah.
To walk around a little bit, but it's quite the...
I've been in the building.
Okay.
I had a chance to sit in the president's chair.
Yes, sir.
There. So,
yeah, wow.
Yeah.
Well, beautiful. It's a beautiful house. Lodge.
Lodge is still leased to a hunt club, but
the
land belongs to
the state
now.
Okay, so it's is that a public hunting ground, or that's private? The state.
I don't know. I don't hunt. So
okay. I was just curious.
But I think they have to allow public hunting a couple times a year because it belongs to the taxpayer.
All right.
I'm not sure.
Yes, sir. I don't know.
It has specific rules different from. Other hunting,
I bet.
Yeah.
Right.
It does.
It has some odd signs out there on the road.
Yeah, it has.
The signs are kind of odd, to be quite honest. Yeah, that are.
Even though it's part of the Maryland Park System.
Yeah, right.
It has specific rules.
Yes, sir. Right. Yeah. All right. Well, like I said, is there anything else significant about the canal that you can share?
The most significant thing, not so much canal up there, but... Mm-hmm. The fact that when Mason and Dixon were surveying the Mason-Dixon line, what we call Mason-Dixon line today.
Yes, sir.
And they were surveying in a westerly direction. They didn't know whether they were far enough north to be above the Great North Bend of the Potomac River there. And they didn't know whether Maryland ended up two pieces. If that straight line they were shooting west went below the Potomac.
Yes, sir.
And so when they got way west along one of the mountains there, they looked west and decided that they were not going to put Maryland into two pieces, but we end up to be only a mile and a half wide up there.
Right.
A mile and a half from Pennsylvania to West Virginia.
Yeah.
So that's one of the oddities of the state and of Washington County.
Wow.
That we're so narrow.
Yeah. So that's it's a mile and a half there.
About a mile and a half, between a mile and a half, 2 miles.
Right.
Yeah, from Pennsylvania line to the West Virginia line.
Right. Right. Interesting. The Seno Canal. There are any good stories on the canal there? Canal history.
Nothing of the folklore type, like you care about the tunnel or down Haunted House Bend or places like that. Routine canal industrial shipping town.
Okay.
And the Little family had large warehouses there, and I'm sure others did too.
And those warehouses are gone now, correct?
Yeah, they were there up until maybe the early 60s, and when all that arson took place in the Hancock area, they were burned.
Wow.
In the arsonists. That was when the Maryland Hotel burned there, and
wow.
they had a real problem with arsonists there for a pretty good stretch back, I guess, in the 70s or 80s in Hancock.
Hmm.
And someone set fire to the little buildings that were along the canal.
Yes, sir.
They probably would have fallen down by now anyway, but still,
right.
They're no longer there. That's right.
Yes, interesting.
And at one time, the last surviving canal boat that you could see,
yeah,
sat in the middle of the canal there in Hancock.
Really?
Yeah.
Hey.
And up until,
huh,
I guess, I it may have been up until the 72 flood.
Right.
I don't know whether that demolished it, but that boat was still in the canal prism at Hancock. And
so all the canal boats we see today are all reproductions.
Oh yeah, yeah.
That was the original one.
Yeah.
That was built in Cumberland.
Well, I don't know about that, but most of the boats were built in Cumberland.
Right.
And I don't even know what boat it was or what
number.
I'm
right.
sure we
sure.
can look it up.
Yeah.
But I remember going up there in the late 50s and taking pictures.
Wouldn't have been great if somebody would have saved that boat.
The remains of that boat. Yeah.
Wow.
And the front part.
Right.
And a good bit of the boat.
Right.
I had not rotted away at that time. I think probably
right.
if it had not gone by the 72 flood, that got the rest of it. But
right. Yeah, I was.
That's the only original canal boat that I ever saw.
Wow.
Was that one.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
I was just in Copenhagen, and you can believe it or not, they have a Viking boat from the, I think it's like the 5th century.
Is that far back? Yeah.
That was taken up out of a preserved in a swamp.
In a water, yeah.
In water, mm-hmm. And they brought it up, and it's in the museum mm-hmm. there. And what an incredible museum that is. That was probably one of the best museums in Europe I've ever visited. But anyway, I was shocked to see a boat that was 1600, 1700 years old. I'm not positive, but it was really old.
Well, because it was in water, it could be preserved. Yeah.
Yeah.
As soon as they get out of water, they have to do something, or it goes to dust.
Right.
There is the remains of a canal boat down at below Dargan Bend on the canal or in the river.
Dargan Bend.
Yeah, yet today.
In the river.
At about milepost 63. Yeah.
It
looks like a sandbar, but it's a canal boat.
You're kidding me.
Yeah, when I was with the Park Service, we used to do a walk down there, and you could walk right out on it. So, yeah, it's sunk with a load of stone.
So how close is that to the fort there, where the fort was?
You mean above Fort Duncan?
Yes, sir.
Oh, I guess that's about 4 miles up above Fort
so
Duncan.
So it's 4 miles, how far from the Antietam confluence?
Antietam is 70, be 7 miles below the confluence. But it's not quite 2 miles below what we call Dargan Bend today on the canal.
That
parking boat launching area.
It's called across from Glenhaven. Glenhaven's across the river.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but just north or just upriver from mile 63.
All right, just find a place in my mind.
Yeah, if you get down there to go to walk to 63 and come back up a couple hundred feet.
All right.
Go down the bank, there's a canal boat stuck in the mud right there.
Why don't somebody get it out?
Oh, he couldn't. It's full of stone. That's why it stayed there. That's why they never got it out. When it sunk, apparently they had gone across over to the Baconian area to get the stone.
Yeah, sure.
And so when they came back across the river, they must have gotten too close to the shore, and of course it stuck in the mud, so there it stayed. It's there yet today. But everybody thinks it's a sandbar, but it's a boat.
And what a story.
And when you walk out on it, you can tell your own boat. You can tell that there's at least that was the way it was 25 years ago.
So this is like an 80-foot boat, right?
Yeah, a complete 90-foot boat.
90-foot boat.
Oh, yeah, full size.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
That's a big boat, John.
Yeah, they were large.
Yeah, right. I mean, that's dramatic. I cannot believe there is a 80-foot boat still in the river.
And
to this day,
with the river,
of course, the river is going to stay preserved.
Yeah,
the water.
And you can see it when the river's down. But most people think it's a sandbar, but it's both.
Now you got me. You got me thinking.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, we used to do walks there when I was with Parks. There's a lot of things that in the park. The park doesn't know about now.
Well, that's a great story. Yeah. To me, that's one of the. That's one of the. That's this is what this is all about.
Yeah.
Right. Interesting. So anything else? Anything else significant about Hancock?
No. At one time, it of course was the second largest town in Washington County.
Really?
It's no longer that. I guess Boonesboro is now.
Yeah.
And Smithsburg, maybe even Williamsport, are larger now because
they've
had a pretty well population exit. But Hancock was. Before I-70, Hancock was a booming little town.
Wow.
You had all kinds of stores there, 5 and 10 grocery stores.
Right.
And then, of course, your restaurants.
Right.
Which they still have today.
Well, it's Ross from a huge area. I mean, that's a whole...
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, geographical area. You only got one voting district out in that whole part of the county.
Both.
For how many square miles, my goodness. It's,
yeah, Hancock district's pretty sizable.
It is. That's the largest voting district in the county, isn't it? Probably.
Area-wise, it may be,
It's dramatic.
It probably is area-wise.
Right. Yeah. Because I know South County, there's a large district down there. And the...
Sandy Hook's pretty big.
Yeah.
So Roarsville. But Hancock, maybe mile or square mile.
Right.
May cover more territory.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, John, I appreciate you telling me the story of Hancock here today.
Well, there's a lot more story to Hancock than what I know.
Yeah. Oh, I understand,
they have a tremendous history up there.
Yeah. Interesting.
But again, I just want
to make sure it was not a port town.
It was not founded as a port town.
Okay.
Yeah, like say Williamsport.
Or Shepherdstown.
And well, Shepherdstown is questionable whether it was founded as a port town, but
it became a port town.
It was a shipping town. Yeah.
Right.
They definitely utilized the canal. They tied in with the national road.
Right.